Thank you. The next item of business is a statement by Angela Constance on Scotland's prison population. The Cabinet Secretary will take questions at the end of her statement, and therefore there should be no interventions nor interruptions. And I call in the Cabinet Secretary, Angela Constance, to make the statement. Up to 10 minutes, please.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I last updated Parliament on the prison population in late February. While population levels were still concerning at that point, we had seen a period of limited overall growth over the preceding 4 months. Unfortunately, Presiding Officer, that has now changed. Over the past 2 months, the population has risen sharply from 7,948 on the 18th of March to 8,348 this morning. Given this sudden increase, I felt it critical to keep Parliament updated, to outline what actions is being taken in response, and to highlight some stark and challenging decisions on which parliamentary approval will be sought over the coming weeks and months. The immediate cause of the sudden increase is unclear, and this rate of growth may not continue. However, with the population having increased by around 13% since the start of 2023, there is extremely limited capacity to absorb even temporary increases. The 8,340 individuals in custody this morning represent one of the highest prison populations ever recorded in Scotland. There is now a critical risk to the continued safe and effective operation of the estate, with multiple prisons essentially full. The Scottish Prison Service's ability to deliver rehabilitative regimes has been severely curtailed, visits to prisoners are becoming difficult to maintain, and there are increasing challenges to the effective delivery of NHS services. It's worth noting that we're not alone in this. Both England and Wales and Northern Ireland are facing similar challenges. The UK Government has announced a number of measures in response, including legislating for a presumption against short sentences, expanding provision facilitating the early removal of foreign nationals, and continuing to extend their early release scheme, with recent reports suggesting that some prisoners may be released up to 70 days early, up from the 18 days last year. Significant work is already underway to address this issue. Since the population began rising again last year, SPS have been at the forefront of managing the situation, and I'd like to thank all of those working in our prisons in increasingly challenging circumstances. SPS have kept its population management strategy under review to ensure the best use of the estate, including introducing a centralised and more strategic process for prisoner transfers. SPS is also exploring the feasibility of adding temporary accommodation, as has been seen in England and Wales. This is not a quick fix, but may become necessary if numbers continue to rise. Excellent progress is being made to optimise the use of home detention curfew, which is informed by risk assessment with individuals released subject to licence conditions. There are currently 97 people on home detention curfew, an increase from around 50 to 60 previously. And SPS's ongoing work will benefit from a 10% increase in its resource budget in 2024-25. Looking beyond SPS, we are taking action in a number of areas. We've increased funding for community justice by £14 million in 2024-25 to £148 million in total. To address the high remand population, we've introduced electronically monitored bail and supported the expansion of bail supervision to all areas. The latest official statistics show that bail supervision is at record levels. We're preparing for the implementation in early July of measures enabling courts to take into account time spent on electronically monitored bail when sentencing as part of the Bail and Release from Custody Scotland Act 2023. And later this year, commencement of provisions from the Children Care and Justice Scotland Bill, it recently approved by Parliament, will end the imprisonment of under-18s, creating further capacity at HMP Pullman. We're also considering whether compassionate release could be used more broadly in appropriate cases. taking into account the ageing population and the prevalence of complex health and social care needs. In all of this, we are working across the justice system and beyond, including with health and social care colleagues in particular, to identify potential solutions. Presiding Officer, despite all the steps underway, however, it's increasingly clear that further action is required. The measures I've described will simply not have as large an impact as is necessary to avert a crisis. And be in no doubt, that is what we are facing. If our prisons are to remain functional and able to house the most dangerous offenders, we have no choice but to take urgent action to reduce pressure on the estate. For that reason, Presiding Officer, I will be seeking Parliament's input on and consent for three measures which I consider are now necessary. The first is emergency release. On 26 May, we will bring into force Section 11 of the Bail and Release from Custody Scotland Act 2023, which was scrutinised by Parliament last year and provides ministers with a power to release prisoners in emergency situations. My hope was that this would never need to have been used. However, as things stand today, my view is that we have reached the threshold for taking emergency action. The sudden and sharp rise over recent weeks, combined with an already high population, has significantly increased the risk to the health, safety and welfare of both prisoners and SPS staff, as well as to the security and the good order of the prison estate. Serious concerns have been formally raised to me by the Chief Executive of SPS, His Majesty's Chief Inspector of Prisons and the Prison Governors Association. If the legal test for use of emergency release is satisfied when the provisions come into force on the 26th of May, I intend to bring forward a proposal for Parliament's consideration as soon as possible within the following 2 weeks. Members will have the opportunity to scrutinise and debate the approach, and in this instance, we will not release a single prisoner without Parliament's consent. And I also want to work with Parliament to expedite that process. My intention is that those released would be serving sentences of under 4 years. Public safety will always be my priority. And I can reassure Parliament that there are protections in place so that no one serving a sentence for sexual offences or domestic abuse will be released, with a governor veto also available. We will, of course, be engaging with victims' organisations, local authorities and other key partners in preparing for any release, and initial meetings are underway. This is not a decision I take lightly, and I appreciate fully the concerns it will raise, but we must ensure the safety and well-being of SPS staff and those people in their care, and that our prisons continue to function effectively to accommodate those who pose the greatest risk of harm. Emergency release, however, will not solve this problem in the longer term. Without more sustainable solutions, there is a risk of being faced with the same decision in a few months' time. The second measure, therefore, is to look again at how we manage the release of long-term prisoners, which was last examined in detail almost a decade ago when Parliament passed the Prisoners' Control of Release Scotland Act 2015. That Act effectively abolished automatic early release for long-term prisoners. The rationale for doing so, to move towards a more individualised assessment of readiness for release, is still valid today. But we need also to take into account the growing population, increasing average sentence lengths, and the potential benefits of increasing the time offenders spend on supervised release before the end of their sentence. My intention is to carry out a short consultative exercise over the summer and to return after recess with a proposal for a bill for Parliament's consideration to change how long-term prisoners are released. And finally, I intend to bring forward secondary legislation to amend the eligibility criteria for home detention curfew, increasing the period of time individuals can spend on release under licensed conditions. As these are affirmative regulations requiring Parliament's active agreement, I look forward to discussing this in detail with the Criminal Justice Committee in due course. In taking this approach and combining emergency release with longer-term measures, my hope is that we can both mitigate the immediate crisis and start to address the trends which have brought us to this point. I fully appreciate the challenges in what I have set out, and working towards cross-party agreement on any measures to be taken will be critical. As I have said, we will not proceed with any of these measures without parliamentary approval. I have written to Justice spokespeople inviting them to meet with me and with the SPS Chief Executive, as how we respond to this situation goes beyond the Scottish Government and is rightly a matter for the whole of Parliament. We will also be publishing a briefing paper to ensure that all MSPs have relevant background information. Presiding Officer, I am genuinely open to discussing with opposition parties what options are available and how best to proceed, but I consider that we have no choice but to act if we are to avoid an unprecedented crisis developing. I welcome the views from members this afternoon and would emphasise once again the need for this Parliament to consider in detail the critical situation we are facing and to come to an agreed, suitable response. Thank you.
Thank you, Cabinet Secretary. The Cabinet Secretary will now take questions on the issues raised in the statement, and I intend to allow around 20 minutes, after which time we will move on to the next item of business. It would be helpful if those members who wish to seek to ask a question could press their request to speak buttons. And I call Sharon Dowie.
Thank you, Presiding Officer, and I thank the Cabinet Secretary for advance sight of her statement. Recently, the Chief Executive of the Scottish Prison Service, Theresa Medhurst, confirmed that 7 of the country's 15 prisons had declared red status due to severe overcrowding. Scotland's prison officers are struggling to cope under the huge pressure they face, and the Prison Governors Association has described the situation as a state of perma-crisis for staff. This situation has spiralled because the SNP have failed to revamp the prison estate. The SNP's failures to deliver new prisons on time and on budget has had a damaging impact on prison overcrowding. We urgently need an update on the plans for the prison estate expansion. Now the Scottish Government are saying that the way to alleviate this problem is to use powers they said they never wanted to use, which would only have been used in an emergency. They want to release prisoners serving sentences more than 4 years, but it is crucial to ensure that individuals released from prison do not pose a risk to the public. And therefore, if the government is going to go down this path, they must ensure it's done in a way where public safety is not put at risk. Caution must be taken and safety checks must be carried out. It's not the time for SNP to further their soft-touch approach to justice. The Cabinet Secretary must be clear with the public for which crimes these criminals were convicted on and how many criminals will be released early. But most importantly of all, can the Cabinet Secretary give us a guarantee that at no time will the public be put at risk in carrying out these measures?
Cabinet Secretary.
Presiding Officer, I thank Ms Dowie for her very important questions, and it is with great respect that I say that a prison population of 8,348 does not smack of soft justice. Neither, however, does it smack of smart justice. So I think all of us in this Parliament need to all ditch our rhetoric, roll our sleeves up, and do now what is in the best interest for our communities. Because make no mistake about it, what happens in our prisons matters. Our prison system is not the end of the line. Most prisoners are released. So if our prison officers and staff can't undertake that important rehabilitative work, that healthcare work, all that happens at the end of the day is people are released and risk is increased in our communities. And I know that we all want, at the end of the day, less crime, fewer victims and safer communities. But we now, because we are in a crisis, a critical risk exists. We now have to focus on the solutions that are needed now. And Ms Dowie spoke very powerfully about the plight of prison officers. I have known many prison officers. I have worked with many prison officers. And what they need right now from us is to know that we stand behind them. Every day they go into work, they put themselves on the line for us and for the communities that we all seek to serve. They need to know that we're with them, and they need to know that help is on the way. And in terms of public safety, Ms Dowie, nothing is more dear to me. Absolutely nothing. Ms Dowie, I'm sure, will be aware of the safeguards that exist in terms of emergency release, in terms of those people that are automatically excluded. And then there is also the further reassurance of the Governor's veto, who can exclude anyone he believes, he or she believes, poses a risk to an individual or indeed to a group of individuals. But you're right, how we do this in a planned, orderly way is imperative. And what I won't do, unlike governments elsewhere, you will never be in the position where you have to drag information out of me. I am being candid, I am being upfront, I am not sugarcoating anything. And I will work collaboratively. We will all need courage, but you will have my absolute commitment to leadership on this issue. And I will work with all of you to support our communities and our prison service.
And I call Katie Clark.
I welcome this statement and the approach being taken by the Cabinet Secretary in trying to consult with other political parties. Scottish Labour have been concerned about the steep rise in prison populations for some time. Can the Cabinet Secretary advise how many prisoners the Government planned to release early and what advice she is receiving relating to that? Can she guarantee that no violent offenders will be released? And can she advise what other measures are being considered? In particular, she will be aware that Scottish Labour have been calling for the modernisation of electronic monitoring systems, including the use of GPRS systems. Can she advise of what work is being undertaken to progress better systems of electronic monitoring and indeed to ensure there is full compliance when it is ordered, given that we know this has been an issue in the past?
Cabinet Secretary.
Thank you, Presiding Officer, and I appreciate Ms Clark's contribution this afternoon. And she raises an important point that while we all understand the well-known drivers that have risen to that long-term growth in our prison population, and I have published a paper this afternoon that will once again narrate that, what has been unprecedented and not predicted is 400 additional prisoners in such a short time. And it is difficult to get underneath the skin of very sudden spikes in the prison population. That does not mean that we won't stop investigating that, but that work cannot take place at the expense of what we need to do to act. So her point in terms of which prisoners in terms of emergency release, that is prisoners who have been convicted, who are serving sentences for sexual offences and domestic violence. There are other statutory exclusions, that is also in the brief that has been published. And her point about GPS, the modernisation of that is important. And she may recall that the last statement I made in Parliament is that we'll look to pilot the GPS technology in collaboration with home detention curfew, given the work we're doing to expand that as a reintegration tool.
Thank you. I now call Audrey Nicholl to be followed by Russell Finlay.
Thank you, Presiding Officer, and I welcome the statement from the Cabinet Secretary. The COVID-19 pandemic saw emergency measures used to facilitate the early release of prisoners across Scotland, with public and other local services coming together to manage a multi-agency reintegration and resettlement response. So can the Cabinet Secretary provide an assurance that a similar coordinated and managed approach will be taken and the process closely monitored to ensure as seamless and robust a release process as possible?
Cabinet Secretary.
Yes, Presiding Officer, it is important that we both learn the lessons of what worked well during the pandemic, but also actually what worked less well. And we do have to have an absolute laser-like focus on our coordination between national and local government with health, housing, drug, alcohol services, benefits, social work and other, you know, third sector groups as well, and that this coordination and communication work will continue throughout the planning and then the operation of any emergency release process. So we will learn the lessons of what worked well, but we will keep a very keen eye on where improvements can and must be made. But this is a time for us all to pull together. There is no monopoly in wisdom here.
I call Russell Finlay to be followed by Ronan Mackay.
Thank you. I begin by accepting the Cabinet Secretary's offer of a meeting to discuss Scotland's prison crisis, and it absolutely is a crisis. Severely overcrowded, rampant drug use and no proper rehabilitation, with organised crime gangs targeting prison officers in brazen attacks. Now, as well as freeing up to 500 prisoners early, the Cabinet Secretary tells us she's considering another significant measure, and that is to bring back the automatic early release of long-term prisoners, those serving more than 4 years. Now, this is despite a previous pledge from one of the previous First Ministers to also scrap it for shorter sentences. Now, Cabinet Secretary, this government is entirely responsible for Scotland's prisons and has been since 2007. So if, in the spirit of the comments earlier made about being candid, automatic early release is a foregone conclusion, are you not better prepared telling people that? Thank you.
Cabinet Secretary.
Presiding Officer, I have fairly well-known views in and around the importance, particularly of those people being released from prison with very complex needs, whether that's due to their risks and their vulnerabilities, whether it's due to the need to properly support and reintegrate people with drug and alcohol problems or mental health problems. And my view as a former prison social worker that if we are going to take a more individualised approach to that, some people need more than 6 months on a community licence at the end of a very long sentence. But I also, the tone and tenor of my statement today, Presiding Officer, and I hope that Mr Finlay acknowledges this, is to first and foremost give Parliament its place. I will bring forward a consultation to take place over the summer, because I am being candid. I do not want us to be in a cycle of one episode of emergency release after the other. We have got to look at those solutions that will address a prison population in the longer term. And the other impacts, which I am utterly committed to, whether it's improving alternatives to remand, building confidence and the profile and the number of community disposals. But right now, we need to take quick action. And what I've laid out to Parliament is the three actions that I am seeking parliamentary consent for. So I think my views are known, but I want to give Parliament its place, Presiding Officer.
I call Ronan Mackay to be followed by Polly McNeill.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I've noted that the prison population has risen by 10% since the Bail and Release Bill was passed exactly a year ago, providing powers over emergency release. During that time, and today in your statement, you said you would not use these powers unless absolutely necessary. What other actions have you taken and considered ahead of using this power?
Cabinet Secretary.
Presiding Officer, it's almost a year to the day when we were all engaged in Stage 2 proceedings for the Bail and Release Bill, where I, as the newly appointed Cabinet Secretary for Justice, entered that bill at Stage 2. And, of course, one of the things that we were debating was the powers in and around emergency release. Can I say, In the year that has followed, our prison population has went up by 700. And I think that speaks for itself. We have, as Ms Mackay says, taken a number of other actions. I'm not going to list them all, but we are optimising the use of home detention curfew. The numbers released on this mechanism have increased, and we have taken action to address the use of remand by introducing electronically monitored bail, expanding bail supervision and enabling courts to take electronically monitored bail into account when sentencing. These are all important measures, but we now need to do more and we need to do it quicker.
I call Polly McNeill to be followed by Fulton MacGregor.
How can Scotland repair its reputation in the long run for holding prisoners in humane conditions, with severe overcrowding impacting on rehabilitation, which is absolutely necessary to reduce offending time out of cells, and worryingly, as the Cabinet Secretary's statement says, access to NHS services? And that one that actually concerns me the most, and I wonder if she could elaborate on that. But can I ask the Cabinet Secretary, will all victims be properly notified of these early release cases? How will it be done, and can it be done in good enough time to give those victims the reassurances that there is no risk to their personal safety?
Cabinet Secretary.
Presiding Officer, I have also shared concerns in and around healthcare for prisoners. My work in this regard started when I was Minister for Drugs Policy, and that was in and around access to recovery and the implementation of medication-assisted treatment standards. And one of the things that I did then with my predecessor in this post, Keith Brown, is that we established the cross-government ministerial group on prison healthcare. And I know people might groan at, you know, yet another committee, and as someone who's been involved in a fair few of committees, I do want to convey to Parliament that the work between Justice Ministers and Health Ministers is of a degree that we are absolutely engaged in each other's portfolios and the detail about what we need to do in terms of people with mental health problems, to improve treatment for drug and alcohol dependency, recruitment for Band 5 nurses, some of the technology improvements required to improve clinical treatment. There is a wealth of work going on in that area. But I do acknowledge that the more people go in prison, that jeopardises all of that good work, and we have to address a rising prison population, and we now have to address it in a way that reduces numbers faster. And I take no pleasure in saying that. But with regards to the point on the victim notification scheme and the victim information scheme that exist, we also have planned improvements to that, and will respond to the independent review of these schemes. And I want to ensure that, as well as engaging with parliamentarians, that I'm also face-to-face engaged with victims' organisations, because I want to ensure that we have detailed and exact planning so that we can move forward with the confidence that we need.
Could I just make a plea at this stage for more succinct questions and answers, as there are still a number of members who would like to pose their question to the Cabinet Secretary. I call Fulton MacGregor to be followed by Maggie Chapman.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I also welcome this statement and the measures to keep our prisons safe. Can I ask the Cabinet Secretary what additional supports will be provided to community justice services to support those leaving prison, and what role these services will play?
Cabinet Secretary.
Presiding Officer, I know that Fulton MacGregor, like me, is a former criminal justice social worker, and he will be under no illusions that any measures we take, whether that's in and around emergency release or in particular if this Parliament agrees to alter the release arrangements for long-term prisoners, that will have an impact on criminal justice social work. So as well as engaging with COSLA, with housing, with victims' organisations, we are indeed engaged and will continue to engage with Social Work Scotland, because we need to be working with all of these agencies, because I recognise that while for these particular prisoners that their release is not unanticipated. I acknowledge that particularly around emergency release, that release could take place or will take place quicker for those who are considered appropriate. And that will place additional demands on local services and the requirement for them to be flexible and responsive. And I have, I'm pleased to advise Parliament, a commitment from my Cabinet colleagues that we all need to be working across government to ensure that we can deliver the necessary community planning that's required.
Again, I really need to have more succinct answers. I call Maggie Chapman to be followed by Jackie Dunbar.
I thank the Cabinet Secretary for her statement. The Lancet recently published research that showed that the chances of a former prisoner dying was highest in the week immediately after release compared to the subsequent months. Alcohol and drug-related deaths followed by suicide were the main causes of deaths in this first week post-release. What assurances can the Cabinet Secretary give that, with the measures she has outlined, there will be appropriate and sufficient resources and support available from public and third sector agencies for former prisoners and the communities that receive them, especially in the days and weeks immediately after release?
Cabinet Secretary.
Presiding Officer, I'm conscious of not enduring your wrath, but can I just quickly say to Ms Chapman, the point she makes is a risk time. Any period of risk is greater at time of transition. And the answer to that is planning, planning, planning and planning.
I call Jackie Dunbar to be followed by Liam MacArthur.
Officer, can I apologise to the Chamber in advance as I am going to have to leave the Chamber after I've asked my question. Very grateful to the Presiding Officer for being so accommodating, for allowing me to do so. I'm pleased to hear the Cabinet Secretary say that public safety is a priority. What measures can she therefore provide on the safeguards that will be put in place before anyone is released early?
Cabinet Secretary.
Presiding Officer, I've already spoken in detail about the planning that will now commence in anticipation of Parliament's approval. Nonetheless, we'll have to start planning. I've spoken about the exclusions, those automatic statutory exclusions, and also the Governor veto, whereby they can refuse the release of an otherwise eligible prisoner if they consider they would pose an immediate risk or harm to a specific individual or group of individuals if released. And Ms Dunbar quoted the Chief Inspector of Prisons, who was rightly challenging the government that we need to have the courage to communicate with people that if our prisons are unstable, that will have an impact on community safety, and it's in the profound interests of community safety for us to take action.
I call Liam MacArthur to be followed by Colette Stevenson.
Thank you. Like Katie Clark, can I welcome the early and constructive engagement the Cabinet Secretary has shown towards opposition members. Prisons, of course, in Scotland have been teetering on the edge for months, if not years, with many routinely running over capacity. At the heart of this, at least in part, is the soaring remand population, something I've raised with the Cabinet Secretary on many occasions. In light of the measures the Cabinet Secretary sets out on early release of some offenders, and with one third of people on remand having been held in prison for over 140 days, can she understand why the public might be anxious about releasing convicted criminals early while holding people yet to come to trial in prison on this scale? And what more can the government then be doing to encourage an increased uptake of non-custodial disposals?
Cabinet Secretary.
Presiding Officer, and that's an absolutely crucial point. It is to my great frustration that while our sentence population increased, that the remand population also increased, whereas normally the remand population goes down as the sentenced population goes up. And in any given day, our remand population sits at 1,800 plus. So there is work that we will absolutely continue to pursue in terms of those alternatives to remand. And the point you make is one I take very seriously because, as I understand it, the legal status of remand prisoners prohibits their release on emergency release. But I will go back and have a look at that, Mr MacArthur.
I call Colette Stevenson to be followed by Brian Whittle.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. With the UK nations having the highest levels of prison populations in Europe, what further actions needs to be taken to get the proper balance of community justice and imprisonment?
Cabinet Secretary.
Presiding Officer, investing as we are in community justice is absolutely core to our overall response. We need to follow the evidence. The evidence tells us that the reconviction rate for someone on a robust community payback order is much lower than someone who has served a short-term sentence. So we need to continue to raise the profile and investment and support for community justice services. What I have to say, notwithstanding the importance of that work, that nonetheless will help us in the longer term, but right now we have an immediate challenge to face.
And I can squeeze in Brian Whistle, if I can please have a succinct question and a succinct answer. Mr Whistle.
As always, Deputy Presiding Officer, the Cabinet Secretary stated that the cause of the sudden increase is unclear, but she wanted to say that the Scottish Prison Service's ability to deliver rehabilitative regimes has been severely curtailed. So could the Cabinet Secretary tell us how many of the new prisoners within this recent spike are repeat offenders, and what action she will take to ensure that hundreds of prisoners who may now be released early do not fall back into reoffending and return to prison?
Cabinet Secretary.
Presiding Officer, for the sake of brevity, there is well-established and published research that speaks to the reconviction rates of particular types of prisoners, and also research that speaks to the reconviction rates of short-term prisoners and also long-term prisoners and life sentence prisoners. So I won't infuriate the presiding officer any further, and I won't repeat that at length. But understanding the spikes is important, but we also have to understand that spikes in population are hard to predict, and that means we need to act, and we need to act now.
Thank you, Cabinet Secretary. That concludes the statement. There will be a short pause before we move on to the next item of business to allow frontbench teams to change position. Thank you.